you. Thank you.
So anyway, what is the name of the show, Mick? First Tuesdays.
First Tuesdays.
Yes.
Yeah.
So Mick, who are our guests tonight? What are we going to be talking about?
I think we, since, you know, there's nothing going on, we figured we'd talk about state politics again, the budget impasse, and just how the sausage is made, or in this case, how it's not being made.
Yes.
So we thought we'd bring up a couple of first-term legislators to join us. Will Guzzardi and Pamela Reaves-Harris. You guys want to come on up? I look younger since you last saw me. All right. I think that's because the last time I saw you, I was grilling you before the election. Yeah. And so I looked probably, you know, meaner or something. I don't know. Maybe that was it.
I don't think so. You were actually very nice.
I was very nice. Oh,
you
you're not supposed to say that to a political reporter.
Okay.
Yeah,
right.
He was a junkyard dog is what he was.
It was a conversation.
So,
We wanted to jump in before we start talking about the specifics of what's going on in Springfield and ask you guys to tell us a little bit about yourselves. Why don't we start with you, Will? This is your second time with us at this show.
It is.
I think the first time you were here, you'd won the primary, right? And you had to go through the formality of an election last November.
That's right.
Which somehow you successfully navigated against no opponent, if I remember correctly.
It's always tough to beat no opponent.
Yeah. Knockwood is the first of many unopposed elections.
So congratulations
Thank
on
you.
That resounding victory.
Yeah.
But tell us, for those who weren't here, tell us a little bit about who you are, why you decided to be a legislator, and I'll out you again for those who don't know this part of the story, that you were a journalist and somehow got in your mind that you wanted to, you know, after covering politics, something convince you wanted to get into it yourself.
Yeah, I tend to use the scare quotes around the word journalist, as I'm sure you do when you're not in front of me. So my name's Will Guzzardi. I am state representative from the 39th district, which is just sort of west and then north of here. So Logan Square, Portage Park, Belmont Craig, and those areas. This, like Pamela, I'm in my first term. I just got inaugurated this January. And it's great.
We got a great crowd tonight.
Yeah. It's from Kath. Yeah. What up?
And you're a Democrat.
And I'm a Democrat.
Get that established.
Yes. Pamela and I both represent city districts, so we are both Democrats.
Yes.
Since
our name is not Mike McAuliffe.
Right. You passed the trivia question.
Thank you. It's the first of many, I hope. I was working, my first job out of college when I moved to Chicago was working for the Huffington Post, doing our version of the local news here in Chicago. And it is sort of the bridge that got me into this work, in that I was covering campaigns and elections and got to meet a lot of young progressive people who had really great and interesting ideas about what Chicago politics was and really more what it ought to be and what it could be and how we could get there. And so that was, I became friends with those folks and sort of got swept up in all that. And also learned a lot about what was going on with the state. And I'm sure this kinds of things that we're gonna get into tonight about how, we have a state budget crisis now, but it's nothing new. And it's really been years and years of underfunding the services that our communities desperately need. And so this was 2009, 2010, and I was writing about the nonprofits and the human service agencies working in Logan Square in my neighborhood that were woefully underfunded and barely getting by and like 6, 8, 10, 12 months behind on their reimbursements from the state. And the state was basically saying, you know, good luck. And these folks needed some sort of redress, and the state wasn't providing it for them. So that got me interested in, well, who is our state rep, and what's going on at the state, and how could that happen better? And so I quit that job in August of 2011 and ran for this seat then. I lost in 2012 and then ran again this past cycle and won in 2014, and now here I am.
There you are, okay. And you were running against the Berrios family. That's an important point.
Yeah,
a member of. One day we'll have the assessor come to this show. I'm sure that'll be an interesting show.
No, wait, you guys, just re-explain to those who may not know what you mean by the Berrios family. And you said, Will, you ran against the Barrios family, and Will is very quick to say, I ran against a member of the Barrios family. Yeah. So offer your two different perspectives on this. Ben, was he running against the whole family?
Well,
in your view?
Papa Joe Barrios, who is your assessor, if anybody owns property in this room and lives in Cook County, he oversees the office that determines what your property is worth, and therefore it plays a key role in determining how much you pay in taxes, because as everybody knows, because you read all my columns, what you pay in taxes is the result of multiplying the tax rate by your property's value. So he's a very important, influential person in the Cook County property tax machine, and he's also a prominent player in local Democratic politics, as he's the head of the Cook County Democratic Party, and he loves his daughter very dearly, and she was the state rep who was the incumbent that you defeated. And so he probably didn't like you a whole lot when you ran against his daughter. Would that be a safe assumption to make?
I have nothing to add to that.
Okay, yeah. So that's why I say when you run against one, you're running against a bigger group. Would that be a fair assessment?
Your words, Ben.
Okay. Yeah, so anyway, a diplomat if I ever saw one. So Pamela, tell us about yourself.
Yes, Ben.
How did you end up on this stage?
Yes. You know, it's interesting because I was just at a legislative conference. I was lucky enough to win a fellowship I applied for, and I was just there last weekend. And so it required that we do a lot of reflecting in terms of how I got into politics. And I really hadn't given it a lot of thought, but having to do all of these exercises that they had us do prior to getting down there, I spent a lot of time thinking about, because I had kind of just given most people the short version, almost the end of how I got into it. But the reality is I remember when President Obama was running for office, my dad was still alive. And he was just so discouraging, like, oh, baby, we'll never see a black man as a president while I'm alive. And I was like, Daddy, don't give up. You know, it's possible. And he's like, no, it'll never happen. And so I remember the night of the election, I had been hanging out with some friends, and I came home, and he was still up, and they hadn't called the race yet. And so whenever I come home, he would literally sit in front of his window. He was on the first floor. And he would sit in front of his window and watch whoever I came home with, whatever I was doing, there peering through the window. And so I saw him peering at me when I was coming home. And I went in, and I was like, you know, I'll sit down and watch the election results with you. And when he won, I saw this expression in my father's eyes. I'm sorry. I apologize. That's the life of an elected official. You get called
Mike Madigan
all the time. I'll put it on mute. Actually, well, you don't want to know who this is.
Yeah. I saw who it is. We'll keep
don't
that our
tell,
little
Bill,
secret.
Don't tell. But anyway, so I saw this expression in my dad's eyes, and he, you know, had tears. And he was a very, you would have never have imagined him doing that. Okay. But I realized that was the first time that I really, really, because I've always paid attention to politics. You know, I've been around political figures, but never always behind the scene. But I really, really got involved, started paying really close attention, not only at the national level, but then at the local level.
So it was in 2008, 2009.
Correct, 2008 and 9. I've always kind of been around it, but not very instrumental, just kind of behind the scenes.
Okay.
But then after that election, I went to the inauguration, and after my father passed, I had a lot of time on my hand, and I had gotten rid of my girls. I shouldn't say gotten rid of, but I had sent them away to college. They were gone, and I had a lot of time on my hands. So I started working in the community as an attorney, just, you know, providing. I went to several of the elected officials and said, you know, I have free time. If you want to do a pro bono clinic, I'm here. And just started getting involved. And it was actually at the time that Derek Smith, he was the current state rep for our district. And he had a promise. It was, you know, he had just gotten indicted, but he had promised the elected officials that because there was some foolery going on in that particular election, someone was in the race pretending to be something that they weren't. It was a Republican pretending to be a Democrat.
Right.
And he promised that if they supported him, that he would step down if he won.
Yeah. Well, does everybody know Derek Smith, the state rep? Was he indicted or arrested at this moment? He was arrested.
First he was arrested.
And then he was, but he was indicted before the primary, I believe.
Okay.
I think he had been indicted.
Right. That's right.
Prior to the primary.
This is for taking bribes.
For taking bribes.
Yes.
Okay.
And so, but anyway, the elected
cash
officials
bribes, right?
for, yeah, $7,000 cash
credit cards.
And so,
to help a daycare center. Yeah.
So go ahead.
And so, but in any event, they agreed that they would collate around him so that they could secure this Democratic seat, but he would step down and then somebody else would be appointed. Well, once he won the primary, he refused to step down.
Slick move.
Yeah. And then, so they ran an independent person against him. In the meantime, he got voted out of the House.
That is correct.
He had got kicked out of the House, and they...
There are some things that are just, you can't tolerate in Springfield.
I'm going to write a book about this, right? I'm going to write a book one day about this whole story.
The bar is low, but...
and then, I've raised it since then, but in any event, he had a problem, so he'd gotten kicked out of the House. They ran an independent party against him.
That's correct.
He still won the general election.
Let's just pause to reflect upon that, people.
After being arrested, and we think indicted,
he won two elections.
He won two elections.
But that first one was, the first one, we'll give him a pass. Let's just assume that the voters were in on the gamut, that it would be a good idea to elect a Democrat so that the Democrat committeemen, including Mr. Berrios, could convene and come up with a replacement.
But the great part of this story is that the Republican, or the other candidate, was a Republican running as a Democrat.
Correct. That's
No, let me say that. He was a white Republican running as a black Democrat.
As a black...
Which is not easy to do.
No, seriously.
He had billboards, I remember, right? Billboards with a black man's face.
And a really good-looking black man. I mean, it was really, really handsome.
Which just wasn't him.
I remember driving around the neighborhood. I was like, man, I might vote for him.
I gotta do that next time. Find a better looking person to put on my billboards. Say it's me. Yeah,
so the voters decided we'd rather have the indicted guy.
Exactly.
Suddenly the voters look very wise.
Yeah. And so, but in the event, he won, and he served his two terms, and then he was running for re-election in the primary. And I remember reading an article in the Sun Times, and it questioned whether or not, because the polls were showing that he was leading.
Okay.
And they questioned whether or not the 10th district can come up with a better candidate.
Yes.
Could we do any better?
Right.
And, you know, I was sitting there thinking it's easy to stay behind the scenes and criticize, but it's one thing to get involved.
Yes.
I live in this community. I live in a house that's been in my district for over 90 years. So my family has deep roots in a 10th district. My girls still live in a 10th district. They plan on keeping the house when I'm gone. And so it was important to me because it was... The 10th district runs from the west side of Chicago, as far west as Cicero, as far south as Roosevelt, as far north as North Avenue, and then it comes east and goes along Milwaukee to Hauston and as far west as...
Are you adjoining districts?
No.
There's one in between us.
Yeah. We're very close. Mm-hmm. But so it's a very diverse district, but a big portion of it is on the west side of Chicago, and it's very poverty-stricken.
Mm-hmm.
And... It concerned me that if he was reelected, not only would we be a national joke, it would not take the district, people would not take the district seriously. Mm-hmm. And there are services that need to be had in our community. And if no one takes the elected officials seriously, then end up for us, the people that live in the district? So I decided to get in the race. So I was asked to run. Looking at the dynamics of the race, and we did an analysis, and the people in the race were not poised to beat him. And I thought, I knew I could beat him. And so I got in and I ran and I beat him.
Yeah. Okay, let's back up. There you go. Now Ben and I were wondering about this before the show. Is the former representative, is he in prison now? He did get a prison term.
He did.
Yeah.
I think he got like 6 months, which was interesting in and of itself. Being an attorney really is interesting. I mean, they spent a lot of money to prosecute this case only to, and then it was interesting because from what I read, the judge, the federal judge, as well as the U.S. attorney were both saying this is not enough time. But they agreed, you know. So anyway, that's what it is. but he only got 6 months.
Now, when you ran, let me get time is eluding me. This would have been a year ago,
a year and a half ago.
A year and a half ago.
Yeah. In fall 13, spring.
Fall of 2013.
But the election itself was March 18th. Right, okay. And at the time, even though Derek Smith was under indictment, I believe, by then, he was supported by Mike Madigan, the Speaker of the House, Mike Madigan, and he was supported by... Well, was Jesse White supporting him? No.
No.
Jesse White did not.
No.
Jesse White, of course, is the Secretary of State. I'm sure everybody in this room has voted for him at least 10 times, sometimes in the same election. And so it's a curious thing where the Democratic Party rallied behind him, which would make it that much more difficult for you to win.
You know, I didn't give a lot of thought to it, to be honest, because from what I understood, that is what... Him being the incumbent, he had been kicked out once. He could not be kicked out for the same offense again. And so it's just the Democratic Party's and Speaker Madigan's position that they support the incumbent. I didn't think about it.
Yeah.
I really did not. I thought if we worked hard, and I really worked hard, seriously, I lost a toenail that I worked so hard. I'm serious. You know, it was so cold.
Yeah.
I got frostbitten and my big toe. And... I lost it.
Okay.
It grew back.
Okay. Happy to hear that.
Maybe I'm telling too much. I'm sorry. but I was
segment
always...
is called oversharing with your elected officials.
I'm sorry, but it's the truth. I literally took a picture. People don't believe me.
All right. Now you had your supporters too, right? I mean, to me, that was one of the interesting things about this race, in addition to, again, the indicted guy being being up for re-election again. Was the fact that the incumbent elected officials from the area were split.
Correct.
So while Mike Madigan was officially behind Derek Smith, Jesse White, as we mentioned, who's also the committeeman of the 27th Ward, backed another candidate.
That's correct.
Eddie Winters.
Correct.
And then and several other elected officials backed him as well. And then you had the support of some other West Side elected
correct.
Officials.
Correct. There was Alderman... Jason Irving supported me as well as Alderman Marino. He was one of my first supporters. He's in the back. Hi, Joe.
Marino was here?
Yeah. Yes.
All right.
He was one of the first
the
elected
twice,
officials that came out to support me.
Okay.
As well as Congressman Danny Davis and the former Alderman Ed Smith.
Mm-hmm.
So those were my most formidable.
And
supporters.
I should tell you, your first supporter, Alderman Moreno, earlier today gave me a piece of advice about how to conduct this panel. He said, hammer him.
Oh, did he?
So
okay.
You know.
Well, we're ready. We're ready.
So there you go.
All right.
Yeah,
yeah.
Oh.
The two go hand in hand. Yeah. So, all right. So both of you actually won by opposing the regular Democratic organization, and now you find yourself as sort of foot soldiers, if you will, in an organization that is very much run by the Democratic Party, or at least the chief official of the Democratic Party, the most powerful person in the Democratic Party, and that, of course, is House Speaker Mike Madigan. So, Will, does that make you feel awkward? Do you ever feel like you want to apologize to Madigan for all the nasty things you might have?
I feel like they ought to have some apologizing to do on their side, right? Man, you guys maybe remember this, probably no one in this room does, but my race got very, very nasty, and there was a lot of really dirty, negative stuff that was said about me during the course of my campaign, which was both untrue and just really too gross to get into now. But
yeah. It was worse than details of your toenail.
Yeah. Right? Yes, yeah. Although that mailer's coming for you, watch out.
Yeah. Rounders people right now.
Yeah, exactly. But no, I mean, things have changed a tremendous amount since our primary, and really it was the election of a new governor. I mean, when I was running, I talked a lot about, and really the motivating reason for my running in the first place was that I thought that the Democratic Party in the state of Illinois wasn't really behaving like Democrats, and they weren't really standing up for the values I thought the Democratic Party was meant to stand for, protecting unions, protecting retirees, standing up for the poor, for working families, right? These are the... And we'd had 12 years of Democratic supermajorities in both chambers of the legislature and Democratic governors, and yet, you know, we had a we kept on passing these corporate tax breaks and cutting funding for social services. So, you know, really the message of my campaign was we need Democrats who are going to act like Democrats and who are going to stand up for our values, right? That was why I ran, and that's what got me elected. And then in the general election, we got Governor Rauner. Yeah, boo is right. I mean, really, let it fly. But, and Pamela can back me up on this. I mean, the thing that's happened is that the Democratic Party and Speaker Madigan in particular, they've really pivoted. And they've really, I think, come home to the sort of core values of the party in a way that I would never have expected. One day we had caucus, and this has happened many times since then, but this was in March or April, we had caucus, and the speaker came into caucus and said, I'll never forget this, and he said, what we're about to get into is a battle for the heart and soul of the Democratic Party. We have to fight for our core constituencies, for labor unions, for the poor, for people who need social. I was like, what? Yeah. Where? Pinching myself, like, am I dreaming? But no, I mean, I think that Governor Rauner being in office has really galvanized the base of the party and also really driven all of us toward our core values, like sent us all home. And it's that's really great. And it's going to be a long, ugly, nasty, painful, difficult fight with this guy. But I think that one of the good things that's going to come out of it is that it's going to remind us of why we're Democrats and what that means. So yeah, so things have changed, and you know that means that my relationship with the speaker, look, we disagree on some stuff, and I voted against some bills that he liked, but by and large, he's been talking, you know, in the kind of ways that I wish he would have for a long time. So that's good, and that's made it a lot easier to sort of, you know, work down there.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I presume you have a pretty good relationship with the speaker now as
well. Absolutely, but it's... As Will is saying, it's easy to because we represent the same core values. Mm-hmm. So it's not as though there has been a lot of contention in the from the Democratic caucus because given the nature of the attacks that's coming from the governor, particularly when it relates to some of the things that truly affect poor communities, which is a big part of my community, it is it's a no-brainer. I mean, it's really... everything that I voted on, and it's amazing to me because people will always say that, you know, you're a Madigan's puppet or, you know, you follow the speaker. The reality is that I'm voting my district. Mm-hmm. And my district is in line with the Democratic Party and the speaker. Mm-hmm. And so it's interesting to me that people have this belief that he's somewhere behind the scenes pulling our strings. I've never felt that. I've never felt that.
Is that right?
And I have not. Okay. And maybe I'm a newbie. I have never felt that. And again, and it could be because what's going on in Springfield is, as Will has said, we see that as an affront to the Democratic Party, to the Democratic values that are important to us and to important to our constituencies. So we kind of rallied together.
Well, let me ask you about that. How does this actually work? I mean, does the speaker or his staff, do they lobby you guys to vote a certain way? Is there pressure on you as a freshman legislators? Are you asked for, you know, is your input solicited, or is it kind of like we'll tell you when we need you to stand up and say aye? I mean, how does this actually work?
For me, the way that it has worked, they will roll call us, but that's no different from what I do when I try to get a piece. Even as a new legislator, there's a couple of bills that I was trying to get support on, so I went around and talked to the different, all of the legislators, including the Republicans, and tried to sell my bill to
you
them.
You talk to Republicans?
I absolutely do, and in fact, I got a lot of support on one of my bills, more so from the Republicans than they didn't give me as hard of a time as the Democrats did. The same process. They will, what they've done to me is approached me and said, this is a bill that the speaker is going to be running. Can you support it? Give me the bill number, let me read it. And then, you know, we would have a conversation. Well, it does this, it does this, it does this, it does this. And I would ask questions. Well, does it have this in it or a sunset clause? Whatever my questions or concerns were. And if it was something I could support, I would support. So far, everything they've asked me that I voted for, I was comfortable with supporting in terms of how it would affect my district.
Yeah, and I've said no to him a couple of times, and that was it. Okay.
Like, on what? Like what stuff?
So I'll give you an example. They had a bill that was about privatizing DCEO. And this was the speaker. The Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity is the state agency that gives out grants to, among other things, businesses, small and large, to encourage business development in the state of Illinois. And one of the proposals that the governor came in with was, well, the state agency that gives taxpayer dollars to companies, let's have it be run by CEOs. That probably will be fine. Exactly. The CEO is right in there. That makes perfect sense. So the speaker, in sort of posturing around this big debate, one of the things he wanted to do was extend an olive branch to the governor, or at least sort of indicate publicly that he was willing to compromise on certain issues. So he wanted to pass this privatization of DCEO in just the way that the governor had, so that now he can go to press conferences and say, look, we've shown the governor that we're willing to negotiate. Mm-hmm. He hasn't shown that he's willing to negotiate. So the speaker ran this bill, and they called me up about it, and I said, no, I'm not going to vote for that. That's like privatization is like a really big thing that I talked a lot about in my campaign. I'm not going to turn my vote for that. And that was it.
And that was actually the bill that I was considering when I was saying I was asking a lot of questions, because I did support it, because one of the provisions required a sunset clause. Mm-hmm. It also had a lot of provisions in there in terms of offering businesses that came to Illinois incentives for putting businesses in minority communities or poverty-stricken communities with unemployment rate.
Yeah.
So I was considering things of that nature and making a determination. And as long as it had a sunset clause, we got to appoint so many people that was on the board. Mm-hmm. And if it helped move some of this logjam in terms of negotiating with the governor, I mean, he is the governor. We have to work with him. We're at a budget impasse. It's getting more critical as time passes on. So if that was the olive branch that they elected to reach out with him, mm-hmm. then I was willing to support that, given the fact that it had real incentives in terms of bringing jobs to my community. And it passed.
It did pass, although it is awaiting action in the Senate now. I think the Senate hasn't taken it up.
But the impasse exists.
The impasse still exists. Yeah. Let me say one more thing. I'm sure we want to talk about that in just a second. But quickly on the Madigan stuff. My experience of being down there as a freshman, and correct me if you have a different view of it, there are certain issues at the very, very top level, like the budget, that the speaker is very hands-on about, right? That he is really, really controlling every step of the negotiations here, and in terms of what bills he calls and when he calls them and all this stuff. But the vast majority of legislating that gets done, and some really meaningful and important bills that got passed and signed into law this year, or vetoed or whatever, some really meaningful bills, substantive stuff, the speaker doesn't really care. He lets you work your bill, and if you can get the votes you need to get, he wants his members to have legislative successes that they can go home and campaign on. So, you know, whether it was the police accountability bill that we passed, that, you know, body cameras and banning chokeholds and all kinds of other good things, the decriminalization bill that I'm sure you guys will want to talk about, of small amounts of cannabis were decriminalized.
And then it was vetoed.
And then it was a mandatory veto.
And I worked very hard on a particular provision of that bill. We can talk about it.
Okay. Yeah. a lot of other things, a lot of really substantive stuff got done this year. And the speaker, it's not as though he worked actively to help it get done necessarily, but, you know, he just let the members do their jobs. So I think there's this impression that everything that happens in Springfield, if it happens, it has his blessing individually. Yeah. And I'm really, in my experience, has not been like that, except for on a couple of really specific issues.
Well, when the interesting takeaway I got from that story you told about that privatization bill, even though the governor got what he wanted, at least in the House, he made no movement to break the impasse.
Right.
So I'm always reading articles by writers and thinkers a little more to the mainstream than I am, and they're always articulating that we must end this, we must find a compromise, and the Democrats must sign on to a compromise. I just read this in the Sun-Times the other day. I think Andy Shaw wrote this. There must be a compromise that can get the state back to work. So to me, from my view, that's always like, okay, there's going to be a sellout. And so do you think there's, like, something substantive that the Democrats will, quote unquote, give Rauner?
You know what's so frustrating when I hear that? There's such a false equivalency between the Democratic Party and the Republicans. We have compromised. The original budget would have been almost $6.7 billion short. It was already difficult enough for us to pass legislation, a spending plan that we thought still protected the most vulnerable of our citizens, and cut $3 billion off of it. The governor originally said everybody knew that in order for us to make this work, it was going to have to take a balanced approach. So we have done our share. It was difficult enough, but we went through, and from the FY 2015 budget, we cut $3 billion already off the budget. So everybody knows that even if we were to give the governor is tying everything he wants, and then what he will say, and he will say this to you, give me everything that I want, and we'll talk about what you need.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Well, let me ask you guys about the governor.
How do you negotiate with someone like that?
On the other hand, the governor's a really nice guy who called you on your birthday, right,
yeah.
Will?
And he called
you, too. I wanted to ask you guys, because we wrote about this a little bit.
We wrote about this,
but I want to talk about your personal interactions with the governor. Were these good faith efforts? Was he just being nice? Was this an actual effort to say, hey, I want to have a conversation about policy? I mean, Will, tell us about the phone call.
I'll tell you about that. It won't take long because it was very brief. But I'll tell you a story of my meeting with him face-to-face about a bill, too. Where to begin with the governor? I think it was actually the day after my birthday. It was in the evening, and I got a call from a number I didn't know, and I answered it, and it was the governor.
You take those calls?
Yeah.
That's impressive.
Literally any call, any number, because it might be someone trying to say happy birthday. You never know. Right?
A day late.
Or 6 months late, whatever. I'll answer. It was the governor, and he said, well, listen, Will, happy birthday. Thank you. It's been great. We'll talk to you soon. really, couldn't have been more than 30 seconds, so not a whole lot of engagement. So early on in his term, he had, breakfasts and dinners and stuff. He invited groups of legislators over to the mansion. And I went over there for breakfast one morning, and he got into it with Mike Smitty, who's a rep from the Quad Cities area, who's awesome. He's like a super, he represents a sort of moderate, very moderate district, sort of Republican-leaning district, but he's a really strong progressive. He's a big champion of labor. He's a good guy on revenue and all the issues that we care about. He's great. Anyway, he got into a big thing with the governor, so I didn't really say much at that breakfast. But I worked on a bill this year that was sort of controversial. It was about standardized testing. I know you guys discussed education stuff last month. And it was about giving parents the right to opt their kids out of state standardized tests. It was a good bill, and it ended up that actually I needed a bunch of Republicans, like 15 Republicans, to vote for it to get it passed, because there were a bunch of Democrats who were sort of close with the protesting education reform type folks who were not that excited about the bill. But what's funny about the opt-out thing is that you get progressive Democrats who like the idea, and you also get these conservative Tea Party Republicans who are like, don't let Obama into my kid's classroom with the test. This will only be enjoyable to Pamela, but Dwight Kaye and Terry Bryant and Avery Bourne, some of the real Tea Partiers voted for my bill and were important votes in getting it passed. I got 64 votes, and you need 60 to pass. I think we had 49 Democrats and 15 Republicans, something like that. Anyway, the governor didn't like the bill. Sorry, this is sort of a long story, but the governor didn't like the bill because he's close with these sort of protesting folks too. So he was trying to convince his members not to vote for it, and they were put in this really difficult position of like, do I listen to the governor or do I do what my district wants?
Do I listen to the governor or do I do what God wants me to do? Yeah. It's a tough call for a Republican in Illinois.
It's really tough. Yeah. The governor gives more money than God.
Anyway, so the governor calls me in his office to talk about the bill right at the sort of heat of the negotiations around it, right before it's about to get called on the floor. And he says, okay, well, tell me about this bill. Okay, well, here's the bill. Here's why I like it. Here's why it works. Well, isn't it going to do this and that and the other thing? Well, no, it's not. You know, here's why it actually is going to work, blah, blah, blah. Okay, all right, well, here's the thing. If your bill comes to my desk, I'm going to veto it. So what I'm asking you to do is just don't call the bill. That was his ask. That was negotiating with Governor Rauner, right? And so I said, look, when it comes to your desk, do what you got to do. I'm going to do my job and pass my bill. And he just sort of scowled at me like this. Okay, Will. Well, all right. And it's my own little personal experience of it, but that's what it's been like with this guy. It's like, here is exactly the thing I want to happen. Do it or walk.
Do you realize when you imitate Rauner, you're like imitating Dave Chappelle, imitating his white friend Chip?
All right. I think that Bruce Rauner sounds like Dave Chappelle's version of a white person to me.
Of Chip, right. His friend Chip. I urge everybody to watch that.
Listen,
So the bill passed, and did it pass the Senate?
Passed the House. It is in committee in the Senate. We're hoping to take it up in veto session. We're also hoping, knock wood, that the state sort of comes to its senses and just resolves this by rule without us having to do legislation. But, yeah, still working on it. Okay. Yeah, but, yeah, passed the House, 64 votes.
Well, speaking of Governor Rauner using his muscle to go after opponents and Republicans, I have to ask you guys, may have already talked to you about this, about these flyers that I've been receiving in the mail. I presume anybody who lives in Chicago has also received flyers. I'm still trying to decipher what...
Exactly.
It's from an outfit. I'm going to screw up their name, and I apologize in advance. I think it's called Illinois... No, there's no...
Growth and opportunity.
I do not believe the word progressive is in the title, yeah.
It's all intended to fool you.
I know the word Illinois is in the title, and I think growth is in the title.
Growth and opportunity.
Go. So I presume everybody else, if you live in Chicago, has received these, and I can't quite figure out exactly what the point of these flyers are, but...
Okay, me either.
You know. But you received one?
I've received them. They weren't addressed to me. My two daughters are registered voters, so they came to them.
That's interesting in itself.
It is.
You're a registered voter, I presume.
I am.
But they came to
my daughters, okay. Which was interesting, but you know, nonetheless. And so I asked my district office whether or not they had received any phone calls, and they probably got 10 out of all four mailers. They got like 10 phone calls from the entire district. So I don't think anyone understands the point of these mailers.
And what do the mailers say, you guys? It's basically saying like Democrats need to stand tall.
It's asking us. I think the intent, I'm just being facetious, but the intent is trying to put us in the position where it's because, remember, the governor tried to pass, or he was suggesting that he would give Chicago additional funds if we were to prevail or pass this legislation that would prevent prevailing wage. He was tying in something into it that was anti-union in terms of supporting CPS and giving them the additional funds to fill some of their shortfall.
Right.
And so I think their initiative is to try to say that if Chicago schools are failing and not getting the adequate fund from the state level, it's our fault.
Okay. Yeah. So I think this is actually really important. So just quick show of hands, who has actually gotten these mailers? Most folks. Not everybody, but most folks. Interesting. So the mail says that Chicago schools are failing, they don't have enough money, and state legislators need to get their act together and fund Chicago schools at a higher rate, which is great, and I agree with completely. But my impression, I'll tell you my theory about this, which I think I've told you, Ben, is that, I mean, this group is funded by a small handful of multi-bazillionaires who are close friends of Bruce Rauner.
Yes.
They have $9 million that they've received, they've gotten from five donations.
And I think they have $20 million in their PAC.
That's right, yeah. And they have this other PAC that has secret money because it's a super PAC. You don't have to tell you how much money it is, but yeah, $20
million. I think
something.
They have $20
million. So their goal, in my view, is to just, and this is Bruce Rauner's overall goal of what this whole thing has been about, I think, since he got into office. There are not enough Republicans in the legislature for him to pass his agenda. So he wants to cause chaos, destroy state government, and then spend his personal resources blaming Democrats for that so that he can win elections against us and replace us with Republicans and then pass his agenda. I think that's the strategy.
And even beyond that, which is interesting, because my district is heavily Democratic.
Mm-hmm, right.
I did have a Republican challenger in my last race. I should have sent him a fruitcake because he made me look brilliant. He really did. I won 85-15.
Okay. Yeah.
But I do have a Republican. I did have a Republican challenger. But so my district is Democratic. They're going to get a Democrat no matter what. So if they run somebody against me in the primary, they're going to still get a Democrat. But the idea is that, because as I started this off, the Democrats and the Speaker defend their members and the incumbents. If the Democrats have to spend a lot of money defending me, then there's 12 seats that are considered target districts or swing districts.
Right.
So if they spend a lot of money running people against us, and they have to defend all of the Democrats in the party, and even their primaries, even though it's a Democratic seat, when it gets to the general election, and they have to defend those swing districts, they'll have less money to defend those Democrats, which could switch the House. And I think that's
his plan.
Let me put
a finer point on something right there, because I think I think what this PAC wants to do is eventually run pro-Rauner Democrats in primaries against people like me and
there's
Pamela.
There's no such thing.
Right, right. Pro-Democrats, right, under the Democratic ticket, right? But so they're spending this money, sending these mailers, trying to make us look bad, and then they're going to find some candidate who's going to claim to be a Democrat who supports the Rauner agenda. They're going to try to replace folks like us with them. And even if they lose, Pamela's right, even if they lose, they're going to force us and the Democratic establishment to tie up our resources protecting seats like ours, which will make us vulnerable to challenges in the seats.
Well, I got to tell you, if I'm a Democrat, I wouldn't tie up money. And just let me remind you that the voters of your district voted for Derek Smith while he was arrested or indicted, I can't remember which, because he was a Democrat. So
yeah.
But
this is
a waste
actually
of money on their part.
Well, I don't know.
On whose part? Wait, not defending me. You
don't
mean that.
No.
Oh, okay.
What a waste of money.
Would never be a waste of money.
I think the point here is that they don't have to actually win these elections in your districts in order to come out ahead. I mean, this is actually the strategy that Rahm Emanuel had when he was the chairman of the Congressional Campaign Committee a few years ago in Washington, where he basically had somewhat conservative Democrats running in what were considered Republican districts, forced Republicans to spend resources defending their own ground, and actually did win a few of those districts by getting war heroes and former college quarterbacks and that sort of thing to run and won a few of those seats. But more importantly, the Democratic Party praised him as a genius for having this strategy. So I don't know. We don't like it. This crowd doesn't like it. But I have to say, I think it's actually smart for a guy who has an unlimited number of resources to force you guys to compete on your own ground.
Yeah. And that's fair. I absolutely agree with you. That's part of the Democratic process. You have a right to run. Mm-hmm. People have to have a right. And I am very, very confident that I can defend my record in my district. Mm-hmm. But that's all I have to say.
As long as Mick brought up my favorite mayor, I have to ask you a question that... we'll turn it over for questions from the audience. Maybe I'll preempt one. The elected school board bill which, as I understand it, is sitting in the Rules Committee of of the House. What's the a number of people have signed on to that as a co-sponsor? What's the that's a bill, obviously, that Mayor Emanuel will oppose, and I believe Governor Rauner opposes it as well. So what's the prospects of that bill emerging, even for debate at a committee?
And the corollary question there for both you guys is, what's the mayor's influence in the legislature? Yeah. Does he have any influence? Mm-hmm.
I think over a small handful of members, maybe, but certainly low right now. So Rahm Emanuel has been pursuing a very similar strategy of blame Springfield for all of his problems, right? That what he's saying about Chicago's finances, which isn't entirely untrue, but certainly maybe exaggerated, is that if only the state would get off their duffs and do something for us, everything would be better. But because the state isn't doing that, I have to make all these horrible cuts. Again, not sure that that's really the true story, but that's the story he's telling. So there's a lot of frustration among our colleagues with that constant sort of media barrage against us. And I think, frankly, the speaker feels some of that frustration too, which, in my view, it's not a coincidence that all of a sudden that elected school board bill is starting to percolate. And, you know, was that too subtle?
No, but he quickest with that. I hear what you're saying. Barbara Flynn Curry came to the city council, and she was Madigan's chief lieutenant in terms of budget issues, and she told them, you're not going to get what you want from Springfield anytime soon, so there's initiatives that you have to take. And she ran down a list, most of which she got from my columns. So,
the smart woman.
So here's the thing. They got the elected school board bill in Springfield. Why doesn't he use that to put pressure on Rahm? Why does he keep that locked in the Rules Committee?
Well, so for a long time, there was no elected school board bill. And in the span of a week or two, there's a bill with 50 co-sponsors on it.
So he may
That's
be.
No coincidence, I think.
Maybe.
I think that he is slowly sort of letting that cat out of the bag.
Absolutely.
Deliberate gesture about Chicago-Springfield relations.
I get you.
Yeah.
Because I think there is a lot of support for it.
Yeah.
Which I support it. And I have been lobbied by some of the mayor's lobbyists or legislative liaisons and asking me specifically how I would vote for it. And I told them I supported it. I campaigned on it. I was at the mayor's town hall last night with regard to the budget hearing. And it was all but a budget hearing because Diet School basically took over, which is, you know, when you know the history, yes. When you know the background of that school, the history of that school, still the only open enrollment school in that community, you know, they've taken a position. And I think the elected school boards would have been able to address that or handle that issue a lot better. If it was, you know, you had people in the community, people that were invested making some of these decisions versus one appointed school board that's making the decisions for the entire Chicago land area with regard to how our schools are run and which ones are open, which ones closed, who gets funded, you know, where's the charter going. It's becoming, when you think about it, it's hard to see not to see the unfairness.
So do you think it's going to get out of the rules? And
that's a whole different, you know, as Will said, there's a lot, when it goes to the budget, because a lot of this has to do with, the first thing we need to do is pass a budget.
That's right.
Well, that was a question I was going to ask you guys before we open up to the audience. Is there any development, any movement in sight on the budget stalemate? Anything going to happen?
Go ahead.
this is exactly what's happening.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Feel free.
So Rich Miller writes this blog called The Capital Facts, which is the like insider Springfield blog, right? And everybody down there reads this blog. And he had read a column maybe last week or 2 weeks ago where he said this bill that's coming up for a vote tomorrow was sort of an opportunity for compromise. So there's this bill about labor negotiations, about binding arbitration for labor contracts, which is maybe a little technical, but it's a bill that Governor really, really, really hates, and he vetoed it,
And the Democrats in the Senate overrode the veto, and it's coming to the House for an override vote tomorrow. And Rich's point in this column was, one of two things is going to happen here. Either the Democrats are going to use that, either the governor will see an opportunity for leverage there and say, look, if you guys don't do this override, I'll start talking to you about the budget stuff, and then compromise might happen, because this is something that the governor feels very, very strongly about. Or he will do the thing he's been doing, which is say my way or the highway, and he'll get the highway, and then we're going to have more impasse.
And I think it's the latter.
Yeah, that's
unfortunately,
what's
happening. I think it's the latter, because I think what you were saying from the onset, his entire agenda is to cause dysfunction. Right. There has been a lot of room for negotiation. There has been a lot of room for compromise. And you know, Will, and I can't get into the specifics, as you said, it's complicated. There's certain things like the property tax freeze. We've run bills, things that he was interested in, mm-hmm. and the Republicans refused to vote on it. And in fact, he's told the Republicans not to vote on it. And these were specific things that he requested in terms of things he wanted. So if there were room to do this, he would have done it already.
But he and the Republicans have said those bills were a ruse. They were a way to so that you guys can say you're trying to compromise, but they really weren't what he's asking.
Well, how?
If you have a supermajority, why are you compromise
it's
at all?
It's bill. I mean,
that's a really important question too. This is something that we get a lot. I don't know if you get this, but there's 71 Democrats in the House, right? It's a supermajority. You can override the veto. It's exactly you need 71 votes to override a veto. So why can't we just ram everything through and get it done? And the sad truth is that there are a couple or three of our colleagues in the Democratic Party who will never, ever, ever vote for anything that looks like a tax increase. They will never vote to raise taxes on anybody for any reason.
And you know what? I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. Because, first of all, even though we do have 71, why should we take the responsibility of doing what is right for this state? We need additional revenues. And the Republicans need to step up at the plate, take that pill, and put us on a path of a financial responsibility to pay down our debt. How are we going to do it?
The Republicans... you talk about a powerful influence over the Democratic Party with Madigan. Bruce Bonner effectively owns the Republican Party at this point. So you're not going to find anybody, I can't think
and
of
I
any
understand.
Republican, to compensate for the three votes, to make up for the three votes that he's alluding to.
And I understand, but there are some Democrats who have to vote their district. You know, even though they might have core Democratic values, their district may be very conservative. If they're representing their district... So, I mean, I used to think the same thing. You know, why we have 71, we have a veto-proof majority. Why can't we get things done, you know, in terms of the progressive tax rate? You know, we should just be able to pass this. And so when we came, when we started talking about the budget, that was one of the first things that came up in our caucus. Well, why don't we start talking about revenues? And the speaker said, get the votes.
Right.
Okay. And everybody shut up,
yeah.
You know, because it is difficult to come up. And that's what's so amazing when people think he's behind the scenes. He has all these powers.
Yeah.
Well, if he, you know, he said, fine, if you want it, get the votes. Yeah. And we will, you know, we will sponsor it. So it's not as easy as people believe. I passed, and I want to give this out because it's really, really important to me. I spent a lot of time on it this first term, being a new legislator. There's a hospital. You're aware of it, Old Sacred Heart Hospital, that's in the district. It's been closed for 4 years now because the previous owners were convicted of perpetrating fraud, Medicaid fraud. Well, I have a group of investors who approached me. They have $20 to $30 million of private money. They purchased the property. They wanted to go to the site and redevelop the site. They could not open up a full hospital because Illinois is considered overbedded. And so they would have still had to go in front of the board to get a show a certificate of need, which they knew they would have a difficult time getting because Illinois is shown to be overbedded, which I still have a whole process with the C of N process. But anyway, they were going to open up this model. It's called a freestanding ER. It was designed after a system that was implemented in Pennsylvania. And basically what it does, they employ a rapid treatment center that cuts emergency wait time down from right now in the city of Chicago, it ranges from 2.5 to 10 hours, depending on, and that's within the 5-mile radiuses of that location. And there's a 25,000 person walk away from ER services because of the wait time. The Illinois Hospital Association fought me tooth and nail. Tooth and nail. They did not want. I remember we had a meeting with the governor. I had several meetings with the governor, and he says, "Oh yeah, yeah, yeah." You know, and then the next thing you know, you'd be like, "I thought we had an agreement." You know, you come out of the meeting thinking you're on the same page, and the next thing you know, it's the total opposite of what the meeting was about. So, I don't even know my point, okay. Other than the fact that it was really frustrating that you work hard, yeah. And I couldn't. Oh, that was the point. I had a better chance of getting Republicans to help me support that bill than I did Democrats, yeah. Which I found very interesting. I did not know that. I just thought we had 71, I can get what I want, yeah. And yeah, it doesn't work that way.
Let's talk about the whole, some of the other demands from the governor are a revamped process for drawing legislative districts,
right.
And also term limits. Yeah. He said that that's part of his so-called reform agenda.
Yeah.
What's your take on that? Any chance of that moving anywhere? Do people in your district care about those issues?
Any chance of moving anywhere? Absolutely not. Just not in the immediate future anyway.
And why is that? Just because it's like not a pressing thing for the Democratic caucus?
Yeah, I mean, shoot, it's. There are agencies in my district, there are child care providers in my district that are turning children away, and there are single parents who can't send their kid to child care and have to quit their job to stay at home and take care of their kid. Like, that's happening right now. And so for us to talk about an independent commission to draw legislative maps, that's a nice idea, but we can do that next year. We need to solve the budget thing now. People are hurting, people are dying, and we're not doing anything about it. So for him to tie that, we'll solve the budget as soon as you give me all these other nonsense things. I don't know. That's frustrating to me. I think the Democratic Party as a whole sort of feels that way about it.
As far as we have term limits, I was just sworn in January, right. And I'm running again.
Right.
I mean, I'm running again. Mm-hmm. We are the only office that runs every 2 years.
Yeah.
You know, so we have to. We're constantly out there. We're constantly addressing. At least I am the constituents, explaining to them what's going on. I have not stopped campaigning since I got into office, yep. In 2013. And so, again, I'm up for re-election. If my district is not happy with me, they can vote me out. I mean, that is term limits to me.
Yes, sir.
Right, from my
understanding. Repeat the question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sure.
Yeah. It was about energy legislation, energy-related legislation.
From my understanding, that has not come out. It's still in, from my understanding, it's still in rules because they're working on a compromise. Mm-hmm. The three bills are going to be consolidated. There's an Exelon bill, a clean energies bill, and I believe he said no to the Exelon because they're asking for a $300 million bailout,
right.
To save the nuclear plants. Will is really, really good at this. He sits on a committee, and he's really on it with asking the questions because it's a very complicated process. After we get out of committee, I ask him questions. So
I don't have any answers. It's super, super complicated stuff.
Very.
But the shortest version of it is that ComEd has a bill, Exelon has a bill. So ComEd is the utility, of course. Exelon is a generator, so they own power plants. And then there's this clean jobs, right. Bill, which is put forth by the environmentalist folks. And there's sort of no movement on this stuff right now, which is good in my view. I know that's a strange thing to say after all what I've been saying, but on this particular issue, Exelon came down to Springfield and was like, we need a bailout right now to save our nuclear power plants, otherwise we're going to lose all these jobs, despite the fact that they're an enormously profitable corporation, mm-hmm. Right? These particular nuclear plants need this bailout. So for us to pump the brakes on that a little bit, I think is a good thing. So that Exelon, we can sort of call their bluff a little bit about those power plants. But because of what the EPA did with the Clean Power Plan, the states are required to make some real changes to our carbon emissions. So there will be a bill that will come forward in the next year or two that I think will have some really good things in it. And it will probably have some sort of odious things in it too, just because that's the nature of making the sausage. But I think on the whole, it's going to be a positive step toward a better energy marketplace for Illinois.
Right now, they're just doing a lot of subject matter hearings.
Yes.
Just to advise the public on what... I agree.
No fracking,
amen. I agree.
The Hideout crowd is firm on that.
I agree.
Yes, sir.
The question is, Governor Rauner has announced a deal with one unit of the Teamsters, and I actually think this is the latest in several deals with the Teamsters.
Right.
And so is that being put out there basically to try to affect the vote you guys are asked to take on labor tomorrow?
Teamsters got theirs, so let's screw halves me.
Well, that's the point is exactly the point that you just made, which is that he's trying to say, I'm willing to negotiate with labor in good faith. I just can't trust him on that, given what he has said about Ask Me and that he's willing to take a government shutdown and a strike and anything to, you know, break this contract that Ask Me has. I really can't trust that he's willing to go in good faith. And look, the bill that we're going to vote on tomorrow, I'll tell you my thoughts about it, Pamela. I'm eager to hear yours. But my feeling about it is this. It's a bill that basically says, negotiate the contracts like you normally do. Do the usual process.
Exactly.
And if you are so deeply entrenched that you find yourself at a complete standstill, then we bring in an arbitrator. And labor and management agrees on who the arbitrator is going to be. And apparently, in the majority of cases, the arbitrator sides with management and not with labor. So this is not as though this is a bill. They're making this out to be a bill that's just going to hand the government employees union everything that they possibly want.
Here come the Reds.
Yeah, right. This is a very sensible proposal. The only thing this is meant to do is keep this governor from shutting down state government to get what he wants. And I think that is something that's in everybody's best interest.
Ditto. I mean, exactly. I absolutely agree. You know, even as an attorney, there's nothing to prevent them from continuing negotiations.
Right.
There's nothing. But I think the state has gone through enough to have them come to an impasse and then to allow the services to be cut down as a result of them not being able to reach an agreement. And I think that is what the governor wants to make the entire to continue to his dismantling of unions. I just think we have to be very cautious and very careful. There's nothing that would prohibit, from my understanding, the same thing. There's nothing that would prohibit them from continuing their negotiations and from them coming up with an agreement. This would only prevent them from striking, shutting down government services, and require them to go to mandatory arbitration. And as Will said, and they both get the opportunity to select the arbitrator. So I support it because, again, I think the dysfunctionality has gone far enough. Could you imagine now we start shutting down stuff and striking, and I just don't want to see that happen. Generally, I believe that employees have a right to strike. They do. But in this particular situation, I would support this bill because I think the state has already gone far enough.
Any questions? Yes, sir.
But isn't a graduated income tax ultimately going to be part of something?
The question is, it seems obvious to this questioner that new revenue is needed. And isn't it inevitable that at some point in time to deal with the situation we're in, a graduated income tax is going to be necessary?
But the point he made is whoever proposes the more revenue first is branded a loser.
That's right. Like,
you're for more revenue.
It's a game of chicken,
You know, I don't know if that's necessarily true. I just think that we don't have the votes. It goes back to being able to get the votes, to get it out and to get it passed, to get it to sign it to law. Because even if it came out of the House and went to the Senate and went to the Senate and they support it and it goes to the governor, he's going to veto it. And so if it comes back to us, we would have to have a veto-proof majority in order for it to pass. And as we've said, there are some Democrats who are a very conservative district who just do not support income tax, progressive or not. I agree. I support a progressive tax rate. I mean, it's just absolutely, in fact, I think that's why we're in the problem that we are in now, mm-hmm. is that we've waited too long. We've kicked the can down the road long enough. We promised all of these services in terms of teachers' pensions, and I support them. You work hard, you're entitled to a pension. They don't pay into Social Security. They're public servants. They should have a right to have a quality of life when it's their time to retire. But the reality is that we were funding certain programs, the teachers' pension program, but there were still social services that needed to be funded. So as opposed to increasing revenues a long time ago to be able to pay for those services as well as fund schools and the teachers' pension, we start borrowing so that we can offset it and give the appearance that we were passing these balanced budgets, when the reality is that we're not. Now we don't have enough revenue come in because we passed that revenue clause, the additional, the 5%, it had a sunset. We don't have revenue coming in, and that was the worst thing they could have possibly done. I wasn't in the legislation, but I would not have supported that 5%. I don't agree because I think it's a Band-Aid. You know, when any time you put a sunset clause on additional revenue and you try to go back to the well, people are going to be pissed. Yeah, they're right. Not going to go for it. So we should have gone progressive a long time ago, but I don't see it happening.
What would it take to get the votes? But that's what we're
knocking doors
about
in McHenry County.
Yeah.
Very inside baseball joke. But let me just say one thing about this, too, about the revenue thing. Because you said you might be in the minority of people who think we need new revenue. You were in the 100% majority.
Not 100%.
Governor Rauner himself started off his term saying, we need new revenue, but first we need all these reforms, right? That was his mantra, and he said that over and over. I know we need new revenue. I'm willing to talk about new revenue, but before we do revenue, we have to do all these reforms. And this is going back to a question you asked a while ago, Ben, about like the sellout, the big compromise, right? So here's what's going to happen in my view. This has been the way this was going to end since the beginning. The speaker, so it's not just about, even if we had 71 Democrats, I think the speaker who would vote for revenue, I think the speaker would be very reluctant to pass a revenue with just Democrats, because then Republicans attack Democrats as the party of the tax hike, right? This is the speaker's mental calculus, in my view. So what he's going to say is, we need a certain number of Republican members, 30 Republican members, to vote for a tax increase. And in exchange, we will give you some budget cuts, probably, and maybe some small elements of the, you know, reform agenda, right? Some workers' comp changes or some changes to tort law, whatever it is. We'll give you some small things. You'll give us Republicans to vote on the tax increase, and that's how this is going to end. That will be the compromise. And depending on what those cuts look like and what the reforms look like, Pamela and I may or may not vote for that, but it's not going to matter because the speaker's only going to need 30 members from the Democratic side to get it passed, because he's going to have 30 Republicans and he's got enough loyal Democrats to do that. So that's how this will end. And the only thing keeping it from ending is the governor not wanting it to be over, right? As soon as he said to his members, let's finish this, we would have that deal in 48 hours. I'm sure the bill is sitting in Mike Madigan's desk somewhere, right? I'm sure of it. And the list of the members is in his desk. And it's a matter of picking up the phone. And I'm not saying that that's pretty or that it's the most desirable outcome. I think we could solve this problem on revenue alone. I don't think we need deeper cuts to social services. They've been cut too much already, in my view. But that's how this is going to get resolved. And it's just a matter of how much longer is Bruce Rauner going to tear down the state before it happens that way.
A couple quick questions. True or false, as far as you know, Mike Madigan has neither a cell phone nor an email address?
As far as I know.
As far as I know, true.
True. Okay.
Right here.
Great question. This crowd.
And I was actually going to ask that question because I believe that soon after right around the time the House passed the decriminalization bill, which the governor issued as a mandatory veto for, Will, you introduced legislation to legalize cannabis, did you not?
No, I didn't. Don't cheer for me so much. Although I do support it, but this is an amazing. Do you remember this? Were you there this day? I had a bill about
studying.
Oh, right. Right. A study bill. Yeah. Yeah. So it just so happened. I have to tell the story. I'm sorry, it's a little bit of a bird walk, but it just so happened that the House was in a bad mood on this day. Yeah. There was a thing that happened between the Republicans. Thanks, Pam. A thing that happened between the Republicans and the Democrats. The Republicans got really pissed off. And my bill was happened to be the next one up. And it was about creating a study of the economic and criminal justice impacts of legalizing cannabis. And the Republicans were mad, so they all pressed their button to speak. And one after another, they're like, well, how's this going to be funded? Well, it's funded by a state agency that already exists. We're not having to hire anybody else. We just tell them to do this. But they just go off on one. And then this thing happened. And this is Ken Duncan's fault. I blame him for this totally. There's a thing in the House called the trophy, the centennial century trophy? Century trophy, which is if your bill gets 100 no votes, you get a trophy. Okay. So the mood in the House had turned on my bill. And Ken Duncan gets up to speak and says, "Is this? I wonder, maybe this thing might be eligible for the trophy." And once there's the specter of the trophy has been raised, people get really excited about it. So my bill got 29 yes votes, which is like embarrassing. You need 60 votes to pass. It got 29 votes. But it did not get the century trophy, which I don't yet.
Great anecdote really underscores the point that you were making, which is that here is a source of revenue, among other things, that could prevent us from having to cut programs and raise property taxes and raise income taxes. Right. And we can't even get a study done.
But what was so interesting about it was that there were a couple of Republicans who spoke during the debate who were like, well, just look at Colorado. I don't know why I have to study it. It's doing great over there. Let's just pass it. So I was like, all right. I'll see you next year.
Yeah, dude.
And actually, I think today, Ken Duncan, who torpedoed my damn study bill by bringing up the trophy. And, you know, he just brought it up, side note, because he has the trophy now for his last dumb bill. I got 100. Anyway.
Literally, the trophy gets passed from person to person.
Yes. So he today, I think, introduced a bill to legalize marijuana in Illinois. And the folks who are working on it are looking for co-sponsors, and they're going to start, you know.
Wait, Ken Duncan did that today?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I did not know that.
So,
not really, he wanted to clear the path.
Well, Will, as a corollary question, the seeming intermediate step would be the decriminalization legislation, which would make, I think, up to like half an ounce essentially a petty offense.
15 grams, I think.
15 grams, which I think is, isn't that like half an ounce?
Oh. I don't know.
Okay, I think it's I think it's roughly half an ounce.
Oh, man, we're all stoned. We don't know.
Yeah. That or you didn't really study the metric system. But so what is it? The governor issued an amendatory veto where he basically harped on a few things in there, including like the driving under the influence.
Well, he brought it down to five grams.
He wanted to really lower it.
Okay. Right. So he wants to make it only the smallest amounts are eligible for this ticket, which sort of guts the whole principle of the bill.
Actually, I did a lot of work on
you
that.
Did. Yeah, that's right.
I did. On the Illinois Vehicle Code and trying to get an amendment to the Illinois Vehicle Code, but it was structured a little differently. And I think had they left it in the original version, it probably would have gotten a lot of support because I was able to argue it out of committee and get it out of committee. And the way it was originally structured was that, because the science does not support, if anybody knows anything about cannabis, is that you can smoke marijuana.
Some here do.
Well, you can smoke marijuana and it stays in your system for several days, up to 30 days, and it doesn't necessarily mean that you're impaired. Currently under Illinois law, if you are driving and if you have any trace of THC in your system, you can be charged with a DUI. It's a zero tolerance. So you could have smoked marijuana 2 weeks ago, and then the irony is that you could be driving, not any fault of your own. Someone hits you. For some reason, you're taken to the hospital. They draw blood. They find any level of THC. You could be charged with a DUI. And if there's any grave bodily harm or death, you can be charged with an aggravated DUI, which carries heavier penalties. And so the original version basically, because the science does not support how much THC has to be in your system in order for you to be legally impaired, there was a compromise. Originally, the way that the statute would have been changed is that if you had any level of THC in your system, but there was no evidence of impairment, so you were driving, you got in an accident, whatever, but you were not, had shown no evidence of impairment, then you could have been charged with a Class A or B misdemeanor. However, in order for them to charge you with a DUI, there would have had to been also some level of impairment. I had made a compromise with the Illinois Bar Association, who originally asked me to sponsor the bill, that because when we took it to the committee, they liked but they wanted some per se level, that if there's so much THC in your system, then there's a presumption of impairment, which would then have been
rebuttable. They wanted a number put on it.
Like
the driving under influence.
Exactly,
alcohol.
Exactly. Yeah. So I agree to the 15, the 15 grams of THC being in your system for there to be a presumption, which would have then been rebuttable. Well, when I was getting ready to argue it on the floor, they came back to me, taken out the Class A, because I think people understand that if there's, right now marijuana is still illegal until it's legal. And so, and if you're driving and you have some in your system, I think they would have been much more willing to pass legislation that said, okay, you're not in DUI, but you can be charged with a Class A or B. So I like that provision. It was easy to argue that. And then, but if you are impaired with this THC in your system, you could still be charged with a DUI.
Right.
And then the 15, the presumption. I think I could have gotten that out, and it could have been signed. But the way they changed it, just to say, okay, no Class A, B, no level of impairment, 15 grams, and then there's a presumption which is rebuttable, then what happens if it's below 15 grams?
Yeah, and it's like micro something grams, whatever.
Yes, and so it got complicated, and so the governor wanted to lower it to 5.
You wanted to make it basically a lower threshold.
The way it is.
Easier,
basically
right.
A zero tolerance, because if you smoke marijuana, there's a good probability that it may be 5 grams, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you're impaired. So in essence,
So we're into really technical stuff, essentially, on this.
I'm sorry. If I got too technical,
no, it's
I apologize.
I think it's the point that it's like, to a lot of people, it's at this point in time, it should be a clear policy path, but we're bogged down in, and the science is even being debated about what numeric
exactly.
level is you know, should be under the influence and all this kind of thing. I guess my question for you guys as we're just wrapping this up is, what is going to happen with the bill? Is it dead? Are you having to start from scratch? Or
the
cannabis bill, by the governor saying, I like the idea of this, but you need to change this and this and this. Does that present an opportunity to get it done?
So there's... with an amendatory veto, one of three things happens. If I remember, we had a lecture on this last time we were down there. So either no action is taken, and the bill just dies. The House does nothing, the bill dies. The House votes to sustain the amendatory veto, which means that it passes in amended form, or the House votes to override the amendatory veto, which requires a supermajority, and it passes in the form that it was originally written. And Kelly Cassidy, who's the sponsor of this bill, is going to... Yeah, give it up for Kelly Cassidy. Wow. All right.
Yeah. On the stage.
She is going to have to figure that out. So she's going to have to do the math on, does she have the votes for the override, or is she just going to accept the... is she going to agree with the amendatory veto and accept it as amended? And I don't envy her that calculation.
I think she actually, full disclosure, now that you're mentioning this, I texted her about something else last week, and she immediately assumed that I was texting her about the cannabis legislation.
Wonder why.
And said, why? I'll know more next week. I think she's on vacation or was on vacation out west. And I said, wait. I'm actually, believe it or not, contacting you about something other than marijuana.
But yeah. I think if they take it back to what they were originally proposing, that would give some more flexibility, because I think when you talk about legalization, you have to take baby steps. Mm-hmm. You know, for people to get accustomed to the idea that you're delegalizing or decriminalizing marijuana. So I think if you take it back to, you know, Class A, B misdemeanor carries nothing. You know, it's a fine. It's a misdemeanor.
Petty offense.
Yeah. So if you take it back, but you feel like you make the Republicans, I'm giving you something, right? So, you know, they feel they have this comfort level that they can go back to their constituents, because they have, remember, and if they vote on this, they have to go back to their constituents to be able to sell it. You got to give them something. So I think if they go back a step, and five is way too low, but put that 15, leave the 15 in, but then if it's below 15 and they're driving under the influence for at least the Illinois Vehicle Code, to still be able to charge them with a Class A, B misdemeanor and require some level of impairment in order for them to be charged with the DUI, I think that would be more palatable. Yeah. And so
just to be clear, and we want to have one more question, we wrap this up, but 5 and 15, we're talking about the possession amounts now. So there's two different issues here. There is the impairment level, the blood alcohol content
DUI.
Level.
Nanograms per
milliliter, whatever, which is part of this discussion. And then there's the actual possession amount, and the governor wants to lower it from 15 to
grams,
5
to 5 grams.
For possession as well, correct. Right. You're right, correct.
Okay,
right.
One more question here. Yes, ma'am. Okay, the question was, first of all, an impassioned defense of the aforementioned McHenry County, and acknowledging that there are people out there, including Democrats, who tend to think of business better than government if it comes down to that equation. So are you guys, what do you guys think of this legislation that would put a tax on sugary beverages?
I agree. I don't support it. Because first of all, generally when you tax something specifically for a cause, it goes to something else. Mm-hmm. It never goes to the cause. I mean, just look at our TIFs. You know,
the lottery,
things, you know, it never goes for the purposes that it was intended. And then I think, you know, I understand the need to address obesity and to be able to fund that, as particularly with the cost of Medicaid and the cuts that's being imposed on Medicaid. But again, I just am concerned that we are taxing the very people who could least afford it. You know, there needs to be a tax. If we're going to start talking about increasing taxes, then we should be taxing people who have the money and not the people who don't have the money. And so I have a problem with that.
So, yeah, I mean, this is a complicated issue, and I have mixed feelings about it. I think the regressive nature of the tax is a real concern. One thing I like about it a lot is that the tax comes in, it's not like the alcohol tax where, you know, when you buy a bottle of booze, when your friend buys a bottle of booze,
they ring it up, and then the tax comes on after the price, right? So it says $19.99 on the bottle, and then they add an excise tax afterwards. So this tax on the sweet beverages would come in before the sticker price. It's on the distributors. So the tax would show up on the sticker price, which all the research says that that's going to create a disincentive to people consuming these products because they're just going to be more expensive when they're on the shelf. So it will drive people away from the sweet beverages, which is sort of the goal. So anyway, it's complicated. I appreciate it for that reason. But just
like with cigarettes, right? Yeah. That does not. I mean, right. It doesn't work. That's it doesn't work. People. What has happened with cigarettes is people generally now are crossing the state line of Indiana,
right.
and paying. Well, and absolutely, but that is in fact. Let me finish. And in addition to that, it's creating a black market in my community. We are arresting people standing on the corner selling cigarettes. 10 cents. So the increased cost is making it more difficult for people to be able to afford them. They're still smoking. I'm not encouraging people to smoke. I'm not encouraging people to drink sugary drinks. I'm just concerned that imposing an additional tax on the people that can least afford it is not going to have the impact that we would want it to have. And so we're charging people more money, but it's not ultimately getting to the cause of the problem, the root of the problem. That's what concerns me. I'm not encouraging it. I just am concerned it won't work.
The issue is, are you doing it to raise... It's like the red lights. Are you imposing them, the red light cameras, are you imposing them for safety reasons, which the mayor said, or are you imposing them because you want to raise money for your budget? Yeah. So... I don't think they're going
to... Can I say something?
Finish your point.
This is... So not now about the HEAL tax. The HEAL Act, it's interesting. It's complicated. Open to talking about it more. But just about the point that you made about business and government, that there's this narrative that business is better than government in some of these Democratic districts. Screw that, man. That's just terrible. And also, shame on us as Democrats for playing into that, because we do. The Democratic Party just rolls over when that narrative comes out, and we say, oh, well, yeah, of course we support, you know, free, unfettered enterprise, but, you know, Medicaid and Medicare, please don't touch those things. Republicans say this stuff, too, and instead of calling them out for being hypocrites and saying that government programs are important, but also, oh, yeah, unfettered free enterprise, we agree with them, and we cave. And it's our responsibility as Democrats to say, you know what, in order to fund the services that our communities need, in order to do our moral responsibility and take care of poor people and sick people and children and the elderly, we have to raise taxes.
Absolutely.
And you know what, those businesses can pay. Absolutely. Like government has an important role to play in society, and it's about protecting people, and we're just too afraid to say it too often. And that's, I don't know, that's all I had to say about that. But that thing drives me nuts.
That's a good place to wrap.
Yeah.
There is one other question I like to end on, but I'm just going to pose it for you guys to contemplate. Who gets indicted next? Okay. Here's to democracy. And all you guys, we'll see you next month. Thank you very much.